My name is Sanjoy Day. I'm representing product management. And along with me, we have presenters Mahadev and Raj, who are going to take it up from me. And we have one more speaker, Sunalini, who's going to join us at the end of the presentation to talk about locationing solutions. Before doing a deep dive into the meat of the presentation today, this is the first time we are hosting you as part of Zebra. And for those of you who are not familiar with Zebra, I just wanted to give you a quick overview of the company to set some context around the new solutions that we are bringing to market. So Zebra legacy has been mostly around mobile printing, barcode printing. It was a $1 billion company. Last October, it acquired the enterprise business of Motorola Solutions, and we formed the $3.5 billion, the new Zebra, better together. So while Zebra is known or has been known for its printing business, one thing that is very different is Zebra has also been on the cutting edge and bleeding edge of some new and cool innovative solutions. One of them, some of you may have heard, is around locationing solutions that have been deployed in NFL franchises for tracking metrics for what is going on in field. The other way is around a platform called Zetar, which is the only one of its kind IoT management platform. Just like we project an avatar of us on Facebook or social media, the whole concept of Zetar is providing a digital representation of a physical asset and providing a manageability construct around it. So with the two companies coming together and with the new Zebra, we are heavily invested into the new category that Zebra has created called Enterprise Asset Intelligence. And asset intelligence is a lot around visibility on physical assets, providing a digital voice to all those physical assets. And wireless LAN or networks in general is a very important cornerstone of this whole solution around EAI, because it gives you the connected edge around which you can sense, analyze, act, and provide actionable insights, right? So there are certain secular trends, and I'll be preaching to the choir. Most of you know about these trends, explosion of connected devices, explosion of mobility. There's another trend around Internet of Things, which is kind of starting to be pervasive in the consumer or the residential space. And very soon, we are going to see IoT in enterprise. In fact, we have a couple of deployments of our wireless LAN networks in big warehouses, a million square feet of warehousing, which is completely unmanned. It's just running on wireless technologies. And that is kind of the start of the automation, robotics coming into these core verticals, warehousing, manufacturing, transportation, and logistics. And finally, with all of these different types of connected things, estimated to be about 30 billion 5 years from now, there is going to be a lot of data, right? A lot of information that is going to come out from these different sensors, wired, wireless, with different types of technologies, Bluetooth, Bluetooth low energy, Zigbee, yada, 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 right? With all of this emergence of data, you really need a system that can provide you with meaningful and actionable intelligence. I mean, unless someone goes and parses the data to provide the actionable insights, the data is really meaningless. And a lot of what Zebra's solution around enterprise asset intelligence, this new category, is predicated upon these secular waves, if you will, mobility, Internet of Things, and cloud enablement of application and analytics. So not only the wireless LAN business, but pretty much every business unit in Zebra is gearing towards this whole construct of sense, analyze, act, whether it's a voice picking solution, whether it's a network solution, whether it's a printing solution. And as I said before, the wireless LAN is a very important cornerstone of this whole solution, because it provides you with connectivity at the edge, that provides you the foundations of the transport. It also provides you with the speeds and feeds, and with solutions built on top of wireless LAN, provide you that first level of analytics that can go to a line of business or that can go to network IT to take, like, you know, proactive action. So while you will see that in the industry there will be, like, you know, trends around speeds and feeds, right? 11N going to wave one, 11AC going to wave two, 11AC, and 3 years from now we might even see in some carpeted enterprise 11AD. It is really the solutions that are going to be stacked up on top of the speeds and feeds that are going to provide more value to the consumer of the technology. So what I'm going to do is hand it over to Mahadev. We are going to do a brief recap of Wing 5, which is an operating system and is an architecture for the Zebra Wireless LAN technology. And then we will cover the first layer of network analytics, the system of visibility called Insight, differentiated, built ground up to match up to the scale requirements of today's and tomorrow's deployments. And from inside the network analytics solution, we'll go to the system of engagement, Impact, which is the unified BLE and Wi-Fi locationing solution and analytics platform from Zebra. So thank you very much, and hopefully you'll have an exciting next 2 hours.
I have the mic. That's back. Thanks. All right, thank you. Thanks, Sanjoy. Welcome, everyone. I'm Mahadev Somasundaram. I'm a product line manager here at Zebra Wireless LAN Business Unit. What I'm going to do is spend a little bit of time, sort of like jog our memories back in terms of the foundations of the technologies what we built over the years since, like, you know, from Symbol days, Motorola Solutions, and Zebra, and how these things are like the underpinnings of, or we can call it as a building blocks for our technologies and the present technology, and also like moving forward, how it contributes in our future technologies. So if you just, like, you know, dial back a little bit, all of this in wireless LAN technology architecture started off with standalone or an independent access points, right? So these are sort of like network of convenience. You know, what it means is like siloed out networks, mainly providing some level of like device connectivity. But there are a lot of impediments. For one, there is no centralized management. Also for the provisioning, it's kind of like cumbersome. You have to do on an individual basis. But obviously, like, that sort of like laid down to the whole idea of like centralized controller, or rather what we call it as a hub and spoke model. And there, it solved the problem of what the earlier generational issues in terms of providing a central management and also providing an ease of provisioning. Which again, like, you know, had a little bit of a bottleneck around that, because now you have a single choke point. All the tunnel traffic all the way comes down to the controller, and if the controller dies down, like, you know, you don't have a individual device level connectivity even at the edges. So there is a challenge in it. As a sidebar note, like, I just wanted to point out that, like, I do have to say that, like, this is one of their pioneer technology, which is from Symbol, when the RF switch or a central controller, which came up as a first to market. Then that led to those challenges what we faced with a central controller or a central choke point, led to the whole idea of, like, you know, combining these two models. You know, you have this standalone model which can operate as an individual or a services at the edge, or also a central controller allows you to do easier provisioning, and also, like, an ability to scale to a larger extent. So the scale is the key point here. So the reason being scale we want to emphasize is the ability to do in a multiples of thousands. So multiples of thousands where you can do the provisioning, the fast provisioning, and also ability to push the services at the edge so that you are not overloading your controller in a way that, like, you know, when you are learning about like tens and thousands, it automatically making sure that, like, your network is continuing to run. So let's drill down a little bit, like, you know, what this hybrid model is, which is all about Wing 5. It's sort of what we want to say is about, hey, you are running the controller code on the access point as well. Like, so there's a single operating system, runs on the controller, runs on the access point as well. Perfect. But That's not the actual thing. It's like, you know, you just want to peel the onion a little bit. What we have done is about separation of a control plane and a data plane. So what that essentially means, it's a simple, straightforward answer would be about running your services on the edge. Of course, like, you know, now you have a controller code running on an access point. Now you can run all the services which used to run on the controller on an access point, perfect. Like, for example, like, you have an application visibility and control. So you, instead of running it on a controller or a centralized management platform, you are able to distribute all the way out to the edge, and every access point can inspect the traffic, identify what type of application it is coming in from the user, and then apply the policies, which is perfect. But we also added a little bit of a secret sauce in it. What it does is, like, internally within a given site, all these access points is a cooperative model, cooperative control plane model, what I call it, where it identifies one of the access points as a domain manager. So what it does help is to identify one as a domain manager and also provides a redundancy. If one of the domain manager fails, another access point takes over as a domain manager. So you have the resiliency. But let's drill down a little bit, like, in what the domain manager does. So the domain manager, typically what it does is, like, in all these localized decisions. Let's take an example. Let's take an RF-related activity. RF-related activities are always localized. In a given setup, like, let's take this room. I have, like, you know, two access points or three access points if I plug it in. The decisions of, like, you know, how I tune the parameters of the RF is typically contained within this, or a little bit of external influence, but not if you're looking at the other far end of this building, I have an access point, like, will that have any confluence into it? Maybe not. So these are localized. So when you have a localized setup and your decisions are localized, what happens is you are not actually paying your controller or a centralized controller, which is sitting all the way in the NOC, to make the decisions, but rather, like, you are making sure that, like, you know, this is confined within these access points. So you are reducing the overhead involved in, like, you know, making the decision, which is going to be a single point in terms of what local site is. That's one important factor. But in addition to that, let's look at, like, you know, once the local decisions are made, how it communicates back to the controller, because you still need some level of statistics, some level of, like, you know, decisions what we take on the local level communicated back to the controller. So what it does is, like, there is always a single channel going back to the controller so that the amount of traffic which goes back is also limited. So what is going to help? It is going to help in terms of how efficiently you're going to use your WAN bandwidth. So if, assuming, like, you have a site which is about 100 access points in a site, and if all those 100 access points, like, collaborate around, like, you know, have a cooperative control plane model which elects one of the access points as a RF domain manager. So RF domain manager talks back to the controller, so only one of the tunnel goes back to send all the traffic information. This is about the statistics. So you're not sending up all the tunnels back to the controller. So this is very efficient way, like, you know, how you're going to manage it. And also pushing down, let's say, for a firmware upgrades. How you want to do a firmware upgrade, you're not setting up a tunnel to all those 100 access points, but rather, like, you know, pushing that firmware down to one of the access point, and the RF domain manager, which is acting as an RF domain manager, and then the manager makes the individual firmware upgrades to all those independent APs.
And how many APs will one RF domain manager support? Thousands or like 20 or like?
So we have a different.
That's a lot of decisions, right, to keep
absolutely
site specific.
Absolutely. So the number of access point it can manage varies depending on the access point model, the SKU models.
Okay.
So the high end of it, like, can support up to 128.
Okay. Still a lot of APs.
Yeah. And in a typical site, you will have, like, multiple RF domains. So you want to segment your network in such a way that you want to localize it. As we mentioned, talked about earlier about how you want to localize the decisions. Like, you know, you don't want to separate too many. If the same parameters, when you're talking about RF parameters, you want to localize it for this particular room, but, like, in a, absolutely not in a conference room which is far end of this building.
And is that an automatic decision, or is it a manual, or both? Or
it's
either?
A configurable. Okay. It's a configurable option, like, in a where how you want to tune this RF domain manager. You want to make it something like, you know, maybe an example I can give you is one of our financial segment customer. Obviously, there is a large distributed site, but also there is one set of, if we can say, like, you know, there is a long floor, which is about, it's a high density deployment with an AP around like 5 feet around. And then this is about like you're talking about 10,000 square feet. So you're talking about 2,000 access points like within that single building. So the number of networks like we had to bifurcate in terms of like number of RF domains, like this is a large number, but also like allows you to segment the network in such a way that the decisions are made within that small segments or small cells.
Okay.
So just of those things, like what it does, we talked about it, but what are the real benefits? So we essentially boils down to the fact that how scalable it is going to be. And our underlying architecture allows you to give you something like your controllers are primarily used for provisioning and collecting the statistics and providing a visibility into what's happening in your network. So you are not putting the network in a way that all the traffic coming back to the controller, you're not making those local decisions based on the controller. So you're pushing down all the way to the edge. So your local decisions are not coming back to the controller. So that's a primary benefit. And each installation or each instance of your controller can scale to a large segment. So that's one of the reasons why we're able to do something like tens and thousands of access points supported on a single controller instance. And then the second benefit is about the redundancy. Obviously, it provides you the capability of running all the services at the edge. So even if the controller is out of commission or maybe due to some level of connectivity loss, your APs continue to operate. So you will continue to have your business critical applications running in the network. And of course, we talked about the efficiency part of it, where your bandwidth can be efficiently managed with the amount of traffic which is going back to the central controller. So now, tying it all together, so how does it fit in? From the IT manager standpoint, what we do is, given the fact that Wing 5 provides you the fundamental basis of how the architecture is laid out, so they don't need to really worry about, or at least the pain point of how the network is going to scale is taken away. We can do the horizontal scaling. We can do, if you want to add more, you can continue to add more controllers, and you don't have to get that pain point of rip and replace. So all these things are solved, but now they want to focus on, hey, how is my network performing? I want to get some level of visibility into this. And I want to get some idea around how the network, from the analytics standpoint, what are the decision-making points I can provide? So that's what the network analytics, which is the Zebra Insight, is going to talk about, which Raj will cover in the next session. And more towards how this line of businesses can take advantage of the robust architecture what we provide, and also the data and the analytics that is fed from the Zebra Insight can be fed into the impact model, where how the customer engagement can be efficiently managed. So that's something Sunali will be talking in the later sessions.